Good evening, everybody. Welcome. My name is Jim Anaya. I'm the Dean of the Law School. Today we're honored to have Lucinda Lowe as the 60th Annual Coen Lecturer. This lectureship was established through the generosity of Adian S. Coen in memory of her husband, John Coen. The lectureship allows us to bring to campus each year recognized experts to address issues of public or political interest. The 60th anniversary of this lecture is a fitting time, I think, to discuss or just talk briefly about John Coen's background. He was born in Iowa in 1885 and came to Colorado to practice law in 1911. He ran for district attorney in the 13th Judicial District in 1916 on a platform consisting of rigid enforcement of the prohibition of law. Coen, a founding member of the Sterling Elks Lodge in 1916, went on to occupy the highest office in the National Elks Organization. And that was a position that was not held by another Coloradan for some 83 years. He served as a regent of the University of Colorado from 1920 to 1922, and then served as chairman of the Republican Central Committee of Colorado from 1924 to 1932. Coen was a skilled orator and perhaps put his gifts best to use in 1925 when he broke with Republican Governor Morley's administration, encouraging party members to repudiate the governor and party members. And he did so, admonishing his fellow party members that they should be ashamed of an administration that had become a functionary of the Ku Klux Klan in Colorado. Coen passed away in 1954, and after his death, his wife Adrian established this lecture series. Over the last 60 years, we've welcomed here at Colorado Law a wide variety of individuals to this podium, Supreme Court justices, law school deans, scholars, attorneys, including Robert Kennedy's speechwriter and the individual who helped to shape the arguments in Brown versus Board of Education, and who represented Miranda in Miranda versus Arizona. I'm confident that the Coens would be pleased to see the high caliber of individuals that the Coen Lecture brings to Colorado Law, and tonight is no exception. We're fortunate to have with us Lucinda Lowe. Welcome, Lucinda. She is a partner in the Washington, D.C. law firm of Steptoe & Johnson, where she heads the firm's Regulatory Enforcement and Public Policy Department and is a member of the firm's Management Committee. She is a widely recognized authority in the U.S. Foreign Corrupt Practices Act and related conventions, and she counsels multinational companies in developing and implementing compliance programs, policies, and procedures. She also provides legal advice and counsel regarding export controls, economic sanctions, and anti-money laundering laws, and has significant experience representing clients in matters involving the World Bank. She is now the president of the American Society of International Law, which is the country's premier organization for practitioners and academics in the sphere of international comparative law. And in 2016, she was appointed by President Obama to serve on the panel of conciliators for the International Center for Dispute Settlement of Investment Disputes. She is a recipient of the William Ray Valance Award presented by the Inter-American Bar Foundation to an individual who has made a significant contribution toward improving the law and jurisprudence of the Western Hemisphere. And although Lucinda now lives in Washington, D.C., her roots are here in Colorado, where she was born and raised. And she practiced law at Sherman and Howard for several years. So welcome back, Lucinda, to Colorado, your home. There's no way I could really adequately describe all of her tremendous accomplishments. We're very fortunate to have her with us today. And so without any further words from me, welcome, Linda.
Thank you very much, Jim. Well, Colorado hasn't changed. It's a lovely spring day, and I thank you for coming out Notwithstanding the lecture, when I saw the snow start this afternoon, I thought, oh, I've been in Washington too long. Because if this weather happened in Washington, D.C., I don't know if any of you are from D.C., but the whole town would be shut down for days. So thank you for coming out, and thanks to Jim Anaya for his very kind introduction, and to the whole event staff, particularly Julianne Williams, who's done such a great job organizing this event. I'm honored to be the 60th Coen lecturer and to follow in the footsteps of so many illustrious predecessors. As Jim said, I am a native Coloradan, although I've spent most of my career in Washington, D.C., but once a Westerner, always a Westerner. Some of you will also know my husband, Daniel McGraw, who was on the faculty here for several years, and I myself co-taught international business transactions here some time ago. So I'm delighted to see the growth and development in the international law program here at CU Law, not only with Jim's coming, but with talented young faculty such as Anna Spain Bradley, who is part of the rising leadership of the American Society of International Law. So my talk today, as you know, is on the Trump administration and international law and institutions. Now, this could be a very brief talk. Or I could say, we don't know, really, even at this stage, what's going to happen. And that's true. Or we have doubts, not only about the future of international law and institutions, but even more fundamentally, about the rule of law in this country. And it's not only the president, of course, that's important when you think about international law and institutions, but it's also the team he or she brings in, as we've seen in other administrations. And that's the team at the cabinet level and at the sub-cabinet level as well. And in that regard, we're still in the very, very early stages of the administration with most of the cabinet in place, but literally hundreds of vacancies in key political positions at the sub-cabinet level. Now, President Trump said a number of things during the campaign that certainly raised significant questions and doubts about his adherence to both domestic and international law. He's modified or backed off some of those statements. And if you've been following his cabinet appointments, some of his nominees in their own confirmation hearings or in subsequent statements have backed off some of those more extreme statements as well. I'm thinking here of Attorney General Sessions' comments on waterboarding, for instance, and Muslim exclusion. And yet, we're facing, in my view, a degree of unpredictability that we've not seen before. Coupled with inexperience of this administration in government and the inexperience of many of his key nominees in government, I think that unpredictability is enhanced. And I believe we can expect some countries to test that inexperience, just as we saw in 1962 with the Soviets and JFK, resulting in the Cuban Missile Crisis. And certainly the world is not without its challenges as we look around the globe. So I do think it's going to be an extremely challenging time for international law and international institutions. I will say a quick word about the American Society, because one of the things that we've done in response to the election is to launch an outreach series, which started on the 1st of February, to try to educate the media, the general public, and policymakers about some key international law issues. These are free hour-long webcasts on particular topics of international law. They're broadcast at a certain time, but then they go up on the ASIL website, and you can watch them at any time. We've done three so far on treaties, the United Nations, and on trade. And tomorrow, we're having our fourth on the environment. So I would encourage you to try to catch some of those because they are, I think, very educational about the topics and really reflect a discussion between past political appointees in high positions in both Democratic and Republican administrations, talking about these issues. We're also in the process, and Professor Bradley is involved in this, of updating a publication that is called International Law, 100 Ways It Affects Our Lives. And if you spend some time looking at that publication, you will see that many things we take for granted in our daily lives, including weather, speaking of weather again, time, travel schedules, and many other things that occur in our daily lives are really the result of the work of international institutions or international law. And we need to educate people about these things. So let me just highlight those two projects, and for anyone who's interested, I can provide more detail afterwards. Before I say more about the Trump administration and international law and institutions, I'd like to put the election into a little bit broader context and talk about what I see as some of the broader, more global challenges to international law and institutions that we're facing today in this world. Because President Trump is not an isolated phenomenon. His election is related to what we're seeing happening in the United Kingdom with Brexit, the Remain vote prevailing in the referendum in the UK in June of last year, and to the rise of far-right nationalist parties in Western Europe. And in my view, we could well be on the cusp of a wholesale reassessment of the international order that everyone in this room has grown up with, and a rise in nationalism in a reaction to globalism. So I'd like to say a few words about that first, and then come back to the US side of things. Now, if you think back about the period, the post-World War II period, for a moment, we saw a dramatic growth, not only in international law, but also in international institutions and mechanisms for international cooperation. And it's really pretty stunning, it was to me anyway, when I started to think about it, how many of the institutions that are around us that we take for granted really are not that old. They're all less than 70 years old. We can start, for example, with the UN Charter. Anybody know when the UN Charter was developed? You know. Some of you are ineligible to answer this question. 1945. Focusing, of course, on peace and security and international cooperation in a variety of areas, and ultimately giving rise to a lot of specialized agencies like the World Health Organization, like the UN Environment Program, and others that are partly responsible for the many ways that international law makes a difference in our lives. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights, a pretty important document, 1948. The Bretton Woods institutions, the IMF and the World Bank, set up to promote development around the world, to promote economic stability, developed in 1944 and went into effect in 1945. The GATT, the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, that has tried to lower barriers to international commerce, 1948. The European Union, what we call the European Union today, started with the Treaty of Rome and the European Community Treaties of Coal and Steel and others, a little bit later than 1945, but in 1957. And that was very much as a goal of promoting cooperation among countries in order to prevent wars on the European continent. The North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO, 1949, a mutual defense pact designed to contain Russia. Those are just a few. There have been many others in subsequent years, some of which I'll touch on when I talk about particular areas. And there's been evolution. The GATT is now the WTO. And we've seen the emergence not just of institutions, but of whole areas of international law that didn't exist before. Human rights, including the rights of indigenous peoples, the environment, corruption, the area that I spend most of my law practice in. Those are all new areas that people who went to law school, even at the time I went to law school, which wasn't 1945, didn't really have the opportunity to study because they didn't exist. Many of these are a consequence of globalization, an increase in cross-border movements of people, of goods, of diseases, and other kinds of threats, of money, of cross-border environmental impacts. They're also a consequence of developments in communications, transportation, and technology, which have shrunk the world. And of course, most recently, we're looking at the digital revolution. Now, there's no question that these phenomena are profound and they're disruptive. In the last couple years alone, we've seen recent mass migrations due to conflicts, particularly in the Middle East, that threaten the very construct of the nation state in some countries. And there may be more to come if the worst predictions of climate change come to pass. Now, these are not things the world or the international legal system has fully grappled with. I mean, you just have to pause for a moment on the issue of privacy as an area that the digital revolution has brought to the fore in various contexts for the individual, for the consumer, the question of their individual rights with respect to issues of security and terrorism, with respect to business. I mean, we all know that data can be moved around the world in nanoseconds with the click of a button. Data can also be stored around the world. And countries at this point have very different views about the degree of protection that should be accorded to that data. And those differences are even between areas of the developed world. The EU, for instance, is much stronger than the US in the protection it gives to individual privacy. At the same time, you see countries, wanting to assert more control over data within their borders. And increasingly in the last few years, data localization rules that try to restrict where information can be kept and processed and how it can be moved. Now, all of these developments do create challenges and strains on the international system, as well as have domestic repercussions. And yet we're still living with the World War II order in many respects. The power is still allocated among the countries that held the power at the time the institutions were created, not fully reflecting the rise of countries like China. And trade agreements, even when they increase economic activity, and the evidence is pretty clear that they beneficially increase economic activity and wealth, they still create winners and losers. Those kinds of changes give rise to insecurity and fears and threats. And it's always easier to blame the threat from without than the threat from within. Even thoughtful people can find these types of changes unsettling. As I've been thinking about Brexit and what's going on in the world, I was reminded of one of my daughters, who was 9 years old when the NAFTA was being negotiated. And her father was directly involved in negotiating the environmental side agreement of the NAFTA. And in our family, it was really an article of faith that NAFTA was a good thing. But she, at 9 years old, questioned this. And when we talked to her about it, she explained why. She'd been to Mexico at age 5. She'd been to the Yucatan. She'd seen Mayan ruins. She'd seen arts and crafts. She'd seen people living a different and interesting way of life. And she told us that she thought trade was good. It was fine. But she didn't want to see everything homogenized. She was really talking about cultural identity. of both the United States and Mexico. She didn't really have a perception of Canada at that point. So it wasn't fear of immigration, and she didn't have to worry about jobs. But it's something I've thought about a lot since both the Brexit vote and the US elections. Now, Brexit was supported by UK voters who felt threatened by immigration and perceived threats to their way of life. As we've all probably read, it generally wasn't in London, which has become a magnet for global talent, but outside London, where the benefits of the European Union are perhaps less visible and the costs more visible, it was perceived as a cost. And it was perceived that bureaucrats in Brussels weren't really responsive to local needs. Now, the withdrawal process just a few days ago, Prime Minister May invoked Article 50 of the Treaty on European Union, which started the withdrawal process. That withdrawal will almost certainly lower the UK's standard of living, reduce their influence in the world, weaken the EU, maybe significantly, maybe even threaten the UK existentially, because Scotland is threatening to hold another referendum. And it's legally quite complex. This is for lawyers, it's actually extremely interesting because you have a very layered and a nature of the EU structure where you have some foundation treaties and then other treaties that are built on those treaties. And so it's quite complex to think about how to both unwind this and what kind of new arrangements just between the EU and Britain you might want to have. And the UK needs market access to the EU. A full 45% of their exports go to the EU. And by the way, if they're going to have that market access, they'll need to meet those EU standards. So they have to live by those rules, even when they're not going to have any influence on those rules after the exit. And it's also unlikely they're going to get that market access on preferential terms that they want, unless they sign up for some of the obligations that the EU views as fundamental. I'm referring here to the so-called four freedoms, which are freedom to move goods, people, services, and capital. There is no other non-EU country that has a trading relationship with the EU of the sort that the UK is asking to have. Switzerland, Norway, Iceland all have preferential trading relationships, but none of them has been able to gain this access without acceptance of these obligations and more. So it's going to be a very interesting negotiation. There's 2 years in which for it to play out unless the parties agree to extend it under Article 50 of the European Union Treaty. And so it's a really two-pronged process. It's not only negotiating the terms of exit, what's the divorce bill, but it's also negotiating the terms of a new arrangement with a deadline. And then there's the question of third countries, like the United States. What's going to be our relationship with the UK and the EU afterwards? Our interests are affected by this, not just business interests, but security interests as well. The EU has a lot of arrangements with the US, both economic arrangements and security arrangements. And so these are all going to have to be reworked to some extent as well. Now, President Trump supported Brexit. Some of you may recall that he was in Scotland inaugurating a golf course when the Brexit vote occurred. And he really saw it as the triumph of nationalists over globalists. But as president, he's really going to have to confront the question of what are the U.S. interests here. He's already indicated that the U.S. and the U.K. should sign a free trade agreement. And that really reflects his preference for bilateral over multilateral arrangements. And that was probably helpful to the UK for him to say that. And yet, how do we do that without really knowing what the outcome of the UK-EU negotiation is going to be? our businesses will want to know to what extent they can count on the UK as a stepping off point for access to the EU, for instance. So we'll have to see how this all plays out. Now, Russia, of course, is very happy with this fracturing in Europe. That suits their interest. And it's also interesting to think about how the Russia-Trump relationship plays into all this. Now, if this sounds like a defense of the EU, let me say that I'm not saying that the EU is perfect. It's very imperfect. In fact, some of the weaknesses, for those of you who like to read American history, would remind you of some of the defects of our own Articles of Confederation, with the difference being that they haven't had an Alexander Hamilton to help them put into place an enduring federal structure. So Brexit and what's happening in the EU reminds us that the nation state is very much alive and nationalism is very much on the resurgence. And that brings me back to President Trump and the United States. Now, President Trump, based on at least his public statements, and he may be very different in private, I confess I have not spent a lot of one-on-one time with him, but I have talked to people who have, and he may be somewhat different in private, but at least publicly, he is vastly unpredictable, deal and power oriented rather than rule of law oriented, seems quite comfortable with alternative facts, appears to be impulsive and vindictive, and as a real estate developer, he's really a risk taker. This is a business activity that is based on taking more risks than in many other types of business. He's also litigious and seems to take advantage of weaker people. Now, how does this all play out in terms of international law? As we know, there was a lot of talk during the campaign about the U.S. withdrawing from various agreements and about sovereignty. And some of that has, in fact, happened. And there's also been expressed hostility to international institutions, even though when you think about it, participation in an international institution, in an international agreement, is not something that's imposed on a country. It's the result of an act of sovereignty. It's the result of an act of consent. So that hostility may be misplaced, but it is there. So we are likely to see in this administration more unilateralism and more, as I already mentioned, more bilateralism than multilateralism. Now let me talk about a few specific areas and how this might play out. I've already touched on trade a little bit, but let me start with that because there have been a lot of developments. Since the inauguration, we've had the unsigning of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP, which I'll come back to. We've had some mixed appointments to USTR and in the White House. And we've had a couple of pretty significant policy statements. In early March, the U.S. Trade Representative submitted to the Congress the U.S. National Trade Policy Agenda for 2017. And then just last week, they submitted to the Congress a proposal on the renegotiation of NAFTA. The National Trade Policy Agenda document singled a strong preference for bilateral over multilateral approaches, and also made very clear a willingness to disregard international law through some very hostile statements about decisions of the World Trade Organization. There are comments such as, U.S. law is the binding principle, and rulings by foreign governments or international bodies have never been and are not now binding on U.S. citizens. The trade policy agenda identifies four priorities. First, defending U.S. national sovereignty over trade policy. Second, strictly enforcing U.S. trade laws. Third, using all possible sources of leverage to encourage other countries to open their markets to exports of goods and services and protect U.S. intellectual property rights. And fourth, negotiate new and better trade deals with countries in key markets around the world. So it seems pretty clear that the big multilateral trade agreements, such as TPP, which President Trump has already withdrawn from, and TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, are dead for the time being. Now, I would point out that there's particular irony in the withdrawal from TPP, because it was an agreement that was negotiated with a dozen countries in Asia with the goal of containing the rise of China. And with the Trump concerns that have been expressed about China, it seems like a missed opportunity for the United States to increase its leverage and linkages with these other countries. China has moved into that breach. They're aggressively negotiating their own multilateral deal. The RCEP, or these all have acronyms, Regional Comprehensive Economic Pact, that will enshrine it as the preferred trading partner in that region of the world. So we may have lost a very important opportunity, and you just can't do bilateral deals at the same rate or with the same effectiveness that you can do a multilateral agreement. TPP, again, probably not perfect, but it was state of the art with respect to some of the newer issues that we're confronting around the world, whether we're talking about environment or corruption or even digital commerce. TTIP, the transatlantic agreement with Brexit, I think is also not likely to go forward. Perhaps less critical from a geopolitical point of view, so we'll be looking at bilateral agreements there. On the NAFTA side of things, I think we've all, if we followed the press, heard Trump's campaign statements about NAFTA. He said he would withdraw from NAFTA or renegotiate. He's also talked about imposing significant tariffs on goods being imported to the U.S. from Mexico and on companies that import goods from Mexico. Besides the risk that that would create of retaliation against the United States, his comments really showed a lack of understanding of just how integrated North American industries have become in the years since NAFTA has gone into effect. The auto industry, as one example, would shut down because their supply chains are not just based in the United States, but are North America wide. So there have been a lot of investments in reliance in the last 30 years. Now, last week, the acting U.S. Trade Representative sent a letter to Congress expressing the intention to renegotiate NAFTA and set out the administration goals in doing that. Now, it's pretty interesting, this statement, on a number of levels. First, it's not a withdrawal. That's the first thing to note. Or another unilateral act. It's talking about renegotiation, and it's seeking to coordinate with Congress. And frankly, the goals aren't as radical as some feared they might be. It talks about the fact that NAFTA needs some updating. It's 30 years old, and it doesn't deal with digital commerce, corruption, or other issues that, as I said just a minute ago, ironically, the TPP, which he withdrew from, dealt with. And it seems to build in this agenda on a lot of international law standards, the WTO, the World Intellectual Property Organization. There's even references to some international labor standards. So it's going to be interesting to see where this goes. Now, in trade matters, the U.S. executive, as you probably know if you've studied trade, acts under delegated authority from Congress. The president does not have the same kind of power he has in trade, as he does in some other areas. And NAFTA itself is a congressional executive agreement. That's not true of the side agreements, but it is true of NAFTA itself. It was executed under so-called fast-track trade authority given by Congress and subject to approval by Congress. And there's implementing legislation. So actually, the executive can't, legally anyway, do things unilaterally. And as we just saw with the healthcare legislation, Congress has its challenges. And then, of course, there are the two other countries as well, Canada and Mexico, who will have their own agendas going into this process and aren't without leverage. Mexican officials have pointed out that the U.S. really needs Mexican cooperation in areas other than trade, like the war on drugs and on other security issues. So there is some leverage. So we'll see what happens with renegotiation. It does imply negotiation, there's the question of what happens if no agreement can be reached after negotiation. So there's still probably a risk of unilateral action at the end of the day if the administration can't get what it wants. And that itself has complexities I won't go into, but the NAFTA itself requires a year's notice. If NAFTA goes away, then there are snapback provisions that go into effect. So it isn't an open door for the administration to do whatever it wants to do. But what we're seeing is a bit of a less extreme picture than we thought we might have to be confronted with. On the investment side of things, the big dispute that the U.S. has been confronting is the Trans-Canada pipeline. Now, as you probably have seen, the administration just announced that it would issue a permit for that pipeline, which has caused a great deal of concern from both environmental and human rights groups. There was a NAFTA Chapter 11 case against the United States that was filed as a result of the Obama administration's denial of that permit, and that case will be effectively mooted at this point. The administration so far hasn't taken a broad position against investment protection. Indeed, the NAFTA letter that it just sent to Congress retains the investment chapter 11, with some tweaks at the margin, and we can talk about that in the questions. If you're interested in that. So that's the picture on trade. Maybe a little bit more rhetoric than reality, but we still have to wait and see. Touching now on peace and security. To me, this is probably the most worrisome area that we look at as we look across the landscape. Certainly, the Trump administration's appointments suggest a continued very strong focus on combating terrorism, and particularly combating ISIS. Now, this, of course, requires international cooperation. It requires intelligence sharing. It may require coordinated responses from the military to other tools of foreign policy, like economic sanctions, which have been used with some success against countries like Iran and others in recent years. And it's going to require the U.S. to confront the international law issues that we've been dealing with in one form or another since 9/11. Torture issues, refugee and displaced persons issues, the law of war, and other things. Here there is a lot of bellicose and aggressive talk. I don't think we know yet what fundamental changes we're going to see. Some of us have doubts on the administration's willingness to resort to institutions like the United Nations Security Council, and the relationship with Russia may complicate that. We know, apart from ISIS, that there are multiple challenges in the world today, North Korea probably being the most significant one, but we have the Middle East, we have Russia, we have Iran. We have China. Our conflicts with China, if we end up in this administration being crosswise with them, could affect the risk calculus with respect to North Korea, because we want and need China to help contain North Korea. With respect to NATO and Western Europe, as you probably know, the Trump administration has made statements about backing off the mutual defense commitments that NATO reflects and making other countries bear more of the financial burden of defense. Weakening NATO, of course, would make the Russians happy. We'll have to wait and see whether the number of military appointments Trump has made could be helpful for some treaties in this area that have not heretofore been approved by the United States. And I'm thinking here of the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, which has been awaiting advice and consent of our Senate since 1994 and has always been supported by the military establishment, primarily because of its rights of passage provisions on the high sea. And with conflicts arising in the South China Sea now, that will become even more important. But so far, I think we've seen no sign that of interest in that going forward. We did think we were going to see early on, based on threats that were made during the campaign, the U.S. withdrawal from the nuclear deal with Iran. But so far, we haven't seen any movement on that front either. And if there's interest in that topic, we can go into it as to how it might work and what would be the consequences in the questions and answer. It's fairly complicated. Let me turn, however, now to another area, which is health, safety, and the environment. And here, of course, the big issue is climate change. And that's what we're going to be talking about in the webcast tomorrow. But I will say, before we get to climate change, there are a whole host of international treaties in the environmental area that have been awaiting Senate advice and consent, for some time. Some of them pretty longstanding, some more recent. I don't think those are likely to be a priority with this administration. And with climate change, what's been on the table, again, has been the issue of withdrawal. Now, what you saw last week from the new administration was a move to undo the Obama Clean Power Plan, which was not the treaty, not any treaty, but domestic implementation actions that were taken in response to the Paris Agreement and were really the centerpiece of the U.S. commitments under the Paris Agreement. Now, the Paris Agreement as a treaty is complicated, and some of you may know a lot about this, but it has both binding and non-binding parts. So the U.S. has not taken steps to withdraw from the Paris Agreement or from the related agreement, the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change. And there are complexities about withdrawal and how long it would take for the U.S. to withdraw, because the two treaties have very different withdrawal provisions. But what the administration has been undoing are the domestic commitments that the predecessor administration made. And I think it's pretty fair to predict that we're not going to see a lot of new initiatives in the environmental protection area over the next few years. Similarly, I think in human rights, it's going to be a tough period for those who have worked to develop human rights law and institutions. Now, this is an area where there's been tremendous growth in both law and institutions since World War II. The U.S. hasn't always been completely on board with these developments. Although we've ratified some treaties, it's often with significant reservations or other limitations, so-called RUDs. And certainly in the queue of 44 treaties that the U.S. has signed, but the Senate hasn't given its advice and consent to, there are a number of human rights treaties, some of which have been pending for a very long time. My favorite on this list, pending since 1980, is CEDA, the Convention on All Forms of, on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women. I don't think, even though there would be a great argument you could make to President Trump, that he could redeem himself in part with women by pushing for CEDAW ratification, I just don't think we're going to see it happen. Indeed, we've already seen some very troubling signs from the Trump administration about its human rights commitments. The U.S. very recently boycotted a hearing of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, where the U.S. was going to be criticized for some of its immigration and refugee asylum policies. The countries that don't show up for those hearings are not a list of countries that we would particularly want to be in the company of. The Secretary of State, Rex Tillerson, also last week, it was reported, had lifted human rights restrictions on arms sales to Bahrain. The UN Ambassador Nikki Haley has made some very disparaging comments about the UN Human Rights Council, which although it's a body with not always the best history, was really lambasted in these comments. And in meetings with Egypt's president yesterday, President Trump sort of put human rights issues into the non-public discussion, even though there's been very strong criticism recently of the human rights situation in Egypt. So the signs emanating to date, and there are more, are not good. Now, there are some scholars who have argued that too much of a focus on human rights has undercut other international norms, and that now is the time to rebalance a bit and give priority on the agenda to a strong core of international law that's dedicated to protecting international peace and security. And some of these scholars even argue that things like the humanitarian intervention by Clinton in 1990 in Kosovo was a violation of international law and encouraged the Russians to do similar things in places like South Ossetia and later the Crimea. These scholars will also argue that the peace that we've enjoyed in recent years is more a function of having more limited territorial disputes, and that the administration should give priority to strengthening rules that reduce conflict over territory and borders. We do have issues, around borders in the South China Sea comes to mind, the Middle East comes to mind, and others. But I think the human rights picture suggests that for those who are committed to that area, and I know there are some of those here, it's going to be likely a time of focusing on trying to preserve the gains that have been made in recent years and avoid a rollback. The same may be true for the area of bribery and corruption. Most of this discussion has been around what may happen to the U.S. FCPA. Trump was quoted as a candidate as having said that the FCPA is a horrible law. He probably has experienced it in some of his international dealings. But the FCPA now is part of an international fabric. In the last 20 years, we've adopted treaties in the OECD, in the UN, in other parts of the world that oblige us to maintain certain standards and work and cooperate with other countries in prosecutions and investigations. So if we walk away in that area, we are going to be risking violation of our international obligations as well. So I've taken you through a few different areas and talked about what we may be looking to over the next few years of this administration. I think it's fair to say that we're not going to be seeing major progress in a number of areas of international law, and really the question is, you know, how much will be rolled back. There's a great deal of work to be done in terms of educating people about the role of international law and institutions in contributing to peace, security, economic growth, development, protection of the environment, human rights, anti-corruption, health and safety, and I could go on. So I hope this has sparked you to think about some of those issues and what you might do to help, because I think this is these are issues, even though they may seem global and remote, they all have linkages to domestic activity. So I hope I've inspired you to think about some of these and what you might do to help preserve the important benefits that international law brings. Thank you, and I'm happy to take some questions. And I see some hands. A gentleman in the blue sweater. Is there a microphone or? Thank you, Julianne. I don't either.
I remember you being very, very positive on just in general the international trends on corruption and how they relate to relations with U.S. and other countries. Do you see and are you afraid that under the new administration there's going to be a backsliding, maybe by example, where the U.S. is no longer seen as an exemplar, if they ever were, in a moral way? Do you see this as a ripple effect that's going to affect other
So thank you for the question. I would say a couple things in response to it. I mean, the issue of corruption is a very interesting issue because it cuts across all sorts of areas of law. There's been a lot of work recently done in the relationship between corruption and human rights. It affects international business. It affects the functioning of governments. It can affect the enforcement of environmental laws, of health and safety laws, of tax laws. So it can cut across a whole range of activities that affect businesses, individuals, and the functioning of the state. And of course, there's the domestic dimension of corruption, and there's the transnational or the foreign dimension of the problem. The U.S. has been a leader, even before the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, you know, coming out of the Watergate era in the United States, we developed a number of reforms, at least at the federal government level, so that you had transparency rules, ethics and government rules, and that sort of thing. Those ideas have been picked up in many of the international treaties. If you look at the UN Convention Against Corruption, or some of the other treaties that focus not just on making things criminal, but so-called preventive measures, they've been picked up around the world. The Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, which is a transnational bribery statute that deals with bribery in international business overseas, was the first law of its type in the world. We now have more than 60 countries that have transnational bribery laws and this treaty network that I alluded to. And the U.S. has been a leader in investigation and enforcement as well. So yes, if the U.S. is perceived as following standards in the conduct of our federal government domestically that don't live up to conflict of interest or other types of rules, or if the U.S. is seen as cutting back on its leadership role in enforcement of the FCPA. Both of those would send very negative messages around the world. As I said, they might actually put the U.S. in breach of international obligations, but more importantly, you can't underestimate in the international world the effect of modeling behavior on other countries. The OECD, which has the leading treaty in this area, functions on the basis of peer review. There are countries who go in and they've evaluated each other in terms of, are they implementing the laws, are they enforcing the laws in a way that meets the standards of the treaties? And we've had success in countries like the UK. The UK, for instance, after the OECD convention went into effect, it was supposed to pass a new law to meet the OECD convention standards. It didn't. What it did instead was say, well, gee, we found this 1906 law, and we're taking another look at it, and as we look at it, we think it's perfect. We'll declare this to be our implementing legislation. Well, the OECD came in and looked at it and said, this is wholly inadequate. This doesn't even come close to meeting the standards that the convention requires. And the UK ultimately passed a new law, which went into effect in 2011 and has resulted in some pretty significant prosecutions, most recently of Rolls-Royce and the supermarket company Tesco. That's an example of modeling. That's an example of the kinds of dynamics you can have in the international arena when a country is leading. So yes, do I worry about how this might ratchet through the system in a negative way if the U.S. pulls back? Absolutely. I mean, not to say that the FCPA is perfect or can't be improved in some respects. It probably can. But when you're talking about things that are inherently international and transnational in effect, and a leading country steps back, then there are going to be consequences. Thank you. There was a gentleman in the print sweater there and then in the front.
I'm curious about specific examples of how international mechanisms and protocols have dealt with corruption. So, for example, let's say with human trafficking in Europe, does Interpol have mechanisms that deal with corruption and bribery, or is that something that they just deal with crime and then that just has to be dealt with domestically?
No, they can deal corruption. And bribery are now, in effect, internationally recognized crimes. And countries who sign up to the treaties, and the UN Convention has more than 140 countries that are party to it now, just as a for example. So all of those countries are bound to work together to deal with the conduct that's defined in those treaties as a transnational crime. And that includes bribery and corruption, and that includes some related offenses such as money laundering and some other things. So you can get, for example, an Interpol red notice issued based on underlying conduct of bribery and corruption. Now, that can be abused by countries, and we've seen some instances of abuse, but those international law enforcement mechanisms are very much available in that area. Yes?
This country started out with slavery, and then we got with slavery, we had Jim Crow, and locked up black people for walking down the sidewalks and drinking out of drinking fountains. That got outlawed, and we've had, 15 years or some of the war on drugs. And we're not the land of free, we're the land more people in prison than any other country in the world, whether it be Iran or China, and that's both a fact as a percentage of the population and per capita. And I always like to say, did Al Capone want prohibition to end? Of course not. He loved only the judges and the politicians and the police officers. So we have Colorado that sells about $110 million worth of marijuana. We have the Singleton Convention, which makes that illegal. I'm just wondering, what is the sort of feedback back and forth between this sort of movement to begin to unwind a failed policy, in my mind, of course the world is reacting to that.
Wow. Why don't I try, since I have the microphone, and I may not do it fully justice, but I think the question relates to some of our domestic challenges with incarceration and the war on drugs. I think those were the two main things that you focused on, and what the international, whether there's an international component to that or pushback against what maybe failed domestic policies or domestic policies that could be viewed as violating international law, perhaps. So I would say that, and others feel free to chime in, because this is a difficult question that I may not know all aspects of. But where I've seen it most is in the reaction to things like the death penalty, which is widely viewed in many countries around the world as a violation of human rights and a violation of international law. And the U.S. has been roundly criticized over the years in a number of different human rights bodies for its policies in that area. I don't know, Jim, do you know? With respect to things like excessive levels of incarceration, that is certainly a practice that could raise issues under some human rights instruments, and I'm not as close to the question of to what extent it's been a subject of discussion in different commissions, but maybe you could speak to that. You know, I'm not familiar with the Singleton Convention. I have to confess. I'll go look it up after this talk. But can someone else comment on that who may be more familiar?
The principal international drug treaty that sometimes opponents of legalization have invoked actually is not a self-executing treaty. It's not one that we're legally obliged to follow. So I don't think international law is going to restrict our legalization.
Thank you.
Can I exercise my pride as dean to ask just one last question? And thank you so much for the presentation, very illuminating. But it seemed to be premised on the belief that international law institutions are in fact a good thing, when that very premise seems to be questioned by the current administration. And the phrase America first, I think, represents best that questioning. And that phrase, I think, challenges the idea that it is in American interests to be engaged internationally. And you said at the end of your talk that international law and institutions do have to do with American interests and do affect us domestically, or the concerns that are being addressed by international institutions are concerns that we have domestically. So could you illuminate a bit upon that premise that you seem to be basing much of your observations on?
Thank you, Jim. So what I would say is I think there is a fallacious premise that underlies the concept of America first. And it has multiple dimensions in my view. One is that the unstated assumption of America first, that somehow things from the outside are being imposed on us that we didn't agree to, we didn't choose, and don't serve our interests. when in fact, I think that premise doesn't hold up when you examine it closely, because international law, let's just take treaties as one form of international law, is based on the consent of countries. It's based on the acts of countries. Countries don't have treaties imposed on them. They sign up for treaties. And as I said earlier, that makes the act of adhering to a treaty an act of sovereign will. And it assumes that sovereign will is typically based on an assessment that whatever the area of the treaty is, it's going to serve the interests of the United States to be part of whatever the mechanism is, to be part of the cooperation that occurs because it helps us enforce the law or deal with pollution problems or something else. So I think it's misguided to assume in the first place that America first is inconsistent with the idea of participating in international agreements and institutions. Now, obviously, in any negotiation, there are trade-offs. And treaties are just that. They're a negotiation. They're a kind of contract in a way. And so you don't get everything you want in a treaty, typically, and there may be things that you're happier with or unhappy with. But if you're going to enter into the treaty in the first place, it's because you think the balance of rights and obligations or benefits and burdens is overall going to be a positive one. So I think this idea that there is inherent inconsistency between an international order that countries are part of and putting your sovereign interests first is just a false dichotomy. And that's one reason I think that the comments that have been made are really misguided. It also ignores what happens if you don't have these kinds of arrangements, because it leaves other countries free to do things to you that are otherwise disciplined by the rules of treaties. I mean, there may be retaliation that occurs. There's a lot of concern that if the United States walks away, for example, from the Paris Agreement, that other countries may decide to retaliate, impose border taxes on the U.S., carbon taxes, and so that you will devolve, if you don't have these kinds of arrangements, into a more lawless world where you may be putting your interests first and doing what you want to do, but other countries are going to feel free to do things too. So there's a benefit that comes from other countries having to be bound by these disciplines. Now, again, there's almost always room for improvement. Things can be updated, things can be changed, new issues can arise. And so adjusting a framework to me is very different than just walking away from rights and obligations. So that's perhaps a partial answer to your question. It's something we could talk about for a long time.
Well, thank you so much. Join me in thanking you.
Thank you so much, Lucinda. And we'd like to invite all of you to join us for a reception now in Boucher Hall right through those doors. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Sorry to throw you such a hard question.
No.